ਵੈਲਕਮ ਟੂ ਦਿਸ ਐਪੀਸੋਡ ਆਫ ਦਾ ਹਰਪ੍ਰੀਤ ਸਿੰਘ ਸ਼ੋਅ। ਅੱਜ ਦੇ ਇਸ ਪ੍ਰੋਗਰਾਮ ਵਿੱਚ ਤੁਹਾਡੀ ਮੁਲਾਕਾਤ ਕਰਵਾਉਣ ਜਾ ਰਹੇ ਮਿਸਟਰ ਬਿਲ ਥੌਨਟਨ ਨਾਲ, ਜਿਹੜੇ ਕਿ CEO ਹਨ BC ਡੋਗ ਗਾਈਡ ਸਰਵਿਸਿਜ਼ ਦੇ। ਇਹ ਉਹ ਸੰਸਥਾ ਹੈ ਜਿਹੜੀ ਕਿ ਡੋਗਸ ਦੇ ਸਹਾਰੇ ਦੇ ਨਾਲ ਉਹ ਲੋਕ ਜਿਹੜੇ ਕਿ ਅੱਖਾਂ ਤੋਂ ਸਹੀ ਤਰੀਕੇ ਨਾਲ ਵੇਖ ਨਹੀਂ ਸਕਦੇ, ਉਹਨਾਂ ਦੀ ਮਦਦ ਕਰਦੇ ਨੇ ਇਹ ਡੋਗਸ ਦੇ ਰਾਹੀਂ। ਆਓ ਅੱਜ ਗੱਲਬਾਤ ਕਰਦੇ ਹਾਂ ਕਿ ਇਹ ਸੰਸਥਾ ਕੀ ਹੈ ਅਤੇ ਜੇਕਰ ਕੋਈ ਇਸ ਦਾ ਫਾਇਦਾ ਲੈਣਾ ਚਾਹੁੰਦਾ ਇਸ ਸਰਵਿਸ ਦਾ, ਤਾਂ ਉਸ ਵਾਸਤੇ ਕੀ ਕੁਝ ਹੋਣਾ ਚਾਹੀਦਾ ਹੈ। Let's welcome Mr. Bill Thornton. Welcome to the program.
Thank you for having me. Lovely to be
here. Most welcome. So Bill, a little bit about yourself. Since how long you have been associated with this organization?
Well, I've been involved with this particular organization since its inception.
Okay.
When my wife and I founded it back in 1996.
Okay. So what prompted you to start this organization?
Well, at the time I was working out of Ontario, and all of the services for blind and vision impaired people were coming out of Ontario,
mm-hmm.
and Western Canada did not have its own guide dog school.
Okay.
So we thought it'd be a fabulous idea to strengthen the Western position by moving over and starting an organization, and as such, that's what we did. Yeah.
Oh, wow. So since 96, you have been working in this field. And what basically does this organization do?
So basically, we do a number of things. We breed the dogs that we need for the programs.
Okay.
We raise the dogs through a strong volunteer group,
mm-hmm.
called Puppy Raisers, in
mm-hmm.
preparing them from young dogs into adults.
Okay.
And then we have professional instructors that work for us that prepare the dogs for the blind and visually impaired individuals, our future clients.
In the dogs, what kind of dogs, what kind of pedigrees are used for helping later on?
Well, that's a great question. Throughout the years, and guide dogs is really, the whole industry has only been going for about 80 years now, so it's relatively new still.
Mm-hmm.
There's been lots of experimentation with different breeds, but really we are establishing now that the Labrador Retrievers and the Golden Retrievers are really the foundation dogs that we would use.
Okay.
But we also would crossbreed the Labrador with the Golden Retriever to give us what we in the industry would think is a third breed.
Okay.
And those are primarily the breeds that you would see today. There are some others,
right?
A few, like a Standard Poodle, and you'll still find some organizations using German Shepherds,
mm-hmm.
which was the very first dogs that were used many, many years ago, just after World War I, in actual fact.
Well, it's been said that dogs are man's best friend, and definitely the way, you know, you're telling about the training, it must be an interesting work. So if you could take us into this kind of training whereby when we are training a dog, especially for normal, you know, use for sniffing or for when the police use it. So what difference is there in between the training, what you give to these dogs who are later used by the visually impaired, and the dogs which are generally trained for other purposes?
Well, and the natural instincts.
Right.
That's really what you're doing. Now, with a guide dog, it's slightly different. First of all, we're going to raise these dogs and train the dogs, and then we're going to give them to a third party.
Right.
We're not going to, the instructor themselves is not the beneficiary of the dog.
Mm-hmm.
And the second thing is, we're asking the dog not to pay too much attention to its natural instinct, but to pay attention to the needs of the blind person by not being distracted, not looking at other dogs, not scenting on the floor or smelling scent in the air and stuff like that. And we're asking them to be very compliant and take care of that individual person with the disability of blindness.
Right.
So there is quite a fundamental change.
Mm-hmm. And also, when you train the person who is to take that particular dog, so how much time do they spend together? And also during that time, now when you say the dog is just focused on helping the visually impaired person, so at that time, tell us a little bit about that. How does that work out? Because how does that dog come to know that what kind of services he's going to give to that particular person?
Well, it's a progressive training. That's
okay.
The best way I can put it to you. First of all, there's a lot of socialization going on when the dogs are youngsters with the puppy raisers,
mm-hmm.
making sure they're very comfortable, like walking into your studio today, making sure a dog just walks in and lies down and it's very relaxed.
Right.
So that's very important. So it's all progressive. As well as, at the same time as we're training the dogs, we're also meeting the potential clients. And generally speaking, we meet them 3 times before we'll actually match them and start to train them with their dog. And by doing that, we know the dog very well because we're keeping records and we're seeing how they progress through the training cycle.
Mm-hmm.
And also, we've seen the people 3 times, so we're really finding out what their needs are, what their capabilities are,
right.
and what their expectation is of the dog. So in a way, we're creating a marriage, and you want to put 2 people together who are going to have a long and happy relationship. That's
right.
The key. Yeah.
Absolutely, and it's a challenging task because
yes.
it's not just breeding a dog and giving away, but it is just training the dog as well as the person who's going to take the dog together.
Absolutely, and once we make that match, then they have a 3-week class training time together,
uh-huh.
One-on-one with an instructor,
right.
and by the end of that 3-week training cycle, they should be really set up for a lifelong successful relationship. That's the goal.
Right. Yep. And also, if you could let us know how many people in British Columbia are using these services, and if anybody who is visually impaired or blind, how can they take benefit of this?
Well, they can contact us directly at our own organization. When we meet people who are looking in terms of being keen to get a guide dog, we tell them first and foremost about what a guide dog can do for them, and then we'll also tell them about the other organizations that are around.
Right.
Many, of course, will apply to us, but we see far more people through that process than we could actually accommodate in terms of training every year. So it's very important that we get the word out, because it's a great mobility tool for a person with blindness.
And what is the success rate when I talk about that once the dog has been given? Because you are in instant communication, and this must be a regular kind of meetings going on. And so when the dogs have gone to the person who has taken them, so at that time, any kind of problems, challenges which the people face or the dog faces, if you know about that, let us know that.
Yes, they can be, both parties could have problems, or the relationship might not work out.
Right.
Generally speaking, if a team gets past 6 months after graduation, they're usually going to be successful. We do keep statistics on that, and we consider a team successful if it works for 8 years.
Okay.
So it graduates at about, the dog would graduate at about age 2 and be retired at age 10.
Okay.
Because just like people, dogs need retirement. It's an important thing, eh?
Right.
It's a great thing for them to have. So we encourage that. And we expect about 80% of our dogs to work to retirement age.
Okay.
You'd never get 100% because
right. There's
all sorts of things can happen, sicknesses and all sorts of things can happen.
Right.
But we think that that's very, very important. We will retire a dog slightly earlier if it works in a very busy environment, like, say, going from Surrey, downtown Vancouver on the SkyTrain every day.
Okay.
It's a much more intense environment. Then we may, if we see a dog's being stressed by this, then we might retire it later. But if you're living out in Hope, say, where it's very nice and quiet, your dog might live, might work just a little bit later than age 10, but never past age 11. We just would never do that. Just depends on the dog. The dogs have needs, you know, they're just
right.
like people that have needs.
Right.
We respect those.
Okay, and Bill, lastly, many times you get amazed when you see a dog with a person who is blind or visually impaired being taken, and at that time, there is a lot of traffic also, and they're crossing the streets. So what is that, in the dog, which makes him understand everything that for a common person,
yes.
you are just amazed, bewildered,
yes.
I would say, that how is that dog coming to know where to stop, when the light is on, he just crosses,
yeah.
and everything moves smoothly. So how does that training is incorporated into the mind of the dog?
Well, basically, we've taught the dogs throughout their training to go down the city block and to sit at the end of the city block.
Okay.
At that point, the client, the blind person, then knows where they are. They're listening to the traffic, and they orientate themselves by listening to the sounds of the vehicles and the traffic flow. So as the lights go red, all the cars on the right are stopping. When the lights change, they go, and the other cars coming towards them or behind them. So most clients that we get understand that concept before we actually train them. Some are better at it than others.
Okay.
But we teach them about traffic flows, and we say go with the flow. So when the cars beside you move,
okay.
then you move forward, so you know you're within the light sequence.
Right.
But of course, there are some light crossings where they have the cuckoos going cuckoo, cuckoo, you know?
Yeah, yeah.
And so there's an audio program as well to help some crossings, but they're not always like that. And there are, of course, one or two crossings where we tell our clients this is far too dangerous, it's too complicated, there's too many filter lanes, there's too many filter arrows for cars to do different things other than the normal flow. Then we suggest that they ask for sighted assistance to cross that street.
Right.
Yeah.
Well, it was a pleasure having you. Thank you very much for your time.
It's been an absolute pleasure. Thank you for inviting me.
Thank you. ਅੱਜ ਬਿਲ ਥੌਨਟਨ ਨੇ ਜਿਹੜੀ ਸਾਡੇ ਨਾਲ ਗੱਲਬਾਤ ਕੀਤੀ ਹੈਗੀ ਹੈ ਕਿ ਜੇਕਰ ਕੋਈ ਵੀ ਵਿਅਕਤੀ ਜਿਹੜਾ ਕਿ ਵਿਜ਼ੂਅਲੀ ਇੰਪੇਅਰਡ ਹੈ ਜਾਂ ਬਲਾਈਂਡ ਹੈ ਉਹ ਵੇਖ ਨਹੀਂ ਸਕਦਾ, ਉਸ ਵਾਸਤੇ ਇਹ ਸੁਨਹਿਰੀ ਮੌਕਾ ਹੈ ਕਿ ਉਹ ਫਾਇਦਾ ਲੈ ਸਕਦੇ ਨੇ ਇਹਨਾਂ ਕੁੱਤਿਆਂ ਦਾ, ਅਤੇ ਇਹਨਾਂ ਨੂੰ ਜਿਸ ਤਰੀਕੇ ਨਾਲ ਟ੍ਰੇਨ ਕੀਤਾ ਜਾਂਦਾ ਹੈ ਇਹ ਬਿਲਕੁਲ ਟ੍ਰੇਨ ਹੁੰਦੇ ਨੇ, ਅਤੇ ਤੋ ਪੂਰੀ ਮਦਦ ਕਰਦੇ ਨੇ ਉਹ ਵਿਅਕਤੀਆਂ ਦੀ ਜਿਹੜੇ ਕਿ ਚੰਗੇ ਤਰੀਕੇ ਨਾਲ ਵੇਖ ਨਹੀਂ ਸਕਦੇ ਜਾਂ ਬਲਾਈਂਡ ਹੁੰਦੇ ਨੇ। ਇਸ ਬ੍ਰੇਕ ਤੋਂ ਬਾਅਦ ਤੁਹਾਡੀ ਮੁਲਾਕਾਤ ਕਰਾਵਾਂਗੇ ਐਸੀ ਹੀ ਇੱਕ ਵਿਅਕਤੀ ਨਾਲ ਜਿਹੜੇ ਕਿ ਡੌਗ ਸਰਵਿਸਿਜ਼ ਦਾ ਇਹ ਫਾਇਦਾ ਲੈਂਦੇ ਨੇ, ਅਤੇ ਕਿਸ ਤਰੀਕੇ ਨਾਲ ਇਹਨਾਂ ਦੇ ਜੀਵਨ ਵਿੱਚ ਪਰਿਵਰਤਨ ਆਇਆ ਇਸ ਤੋਂ ਤੁਹਾਨੂੰ ਜਾਣੂ ਕਰਾਉਂਦੇ ਹਾਂ ਇਸ ਬ੍ਰੇਕ ਤੋਂ ਬਾਅਦ।